السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم. I welcome our dear brothers and sisters in Islam to the session entitled الآداب العشرة, the 10 etiquettes, manners, behavioral practices, protocols when dealing with others, when dealing with yourself, when you are eating, when you are sleeping, when you meet one another, etc. We find in the Arabic language the term al-adab. This is much wider and much wide-ranging than just etiquettes or manners or protocols. It includes all those matters that the Sharia has praised and the custom and the norms of the people have also praised. And it is becoming upon the student of sacred knowledge, the student of ilm, that they, before anyone else, they should embody these manners and these practices and these etiquettes, insha'Allah. Sheikh Saleh Al-Usaymi from Saudi Arabia, he's put together these 10. They are not the most important, but they are important. In fact, if you want further details, you could pick up the book translated by Dar As-Salam Publications, The Book of Manners. And this is in hundreds of pages, dealing with all the extensive details related to behavior, related to etiquettes, protocols, etc. We will just cover 10 very important ones, bi-ithnillahi ta'ala, and even that, we will not be going into super detail. If we had to, then this session would take hours on end. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amat Allah, we begin with the first etiquette, and the etiquette of giving salam to one another. If you meet a Muslim, then you give them the salam. When you meet a Muslim, you give them the salam. We understand from that. If I meet a non-Muslim, do I say to the Christian or the Jew or the Hindu, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah? No, you do not say that. You can greet them with any other greeting, but the greeting of Assalamu alaikum or Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah or Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, this is reserved for your Muslim brother or your Muslim sister, insha'Allah. Whether you know them, whether you don't know them, in fact, it's a sign of Qiyamah, it's a sign of the hour, that we only greet people who we know. We should greet everyone out there who is Muslim, whether you know them, whether you do not know them. And this includes whether you meet them in person, face to face, or hukman, via the telephone, via the internet, you are chatting. The first matter you would begin with, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, my dear brother. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, sister, etc., etc. And so we begin our greeting with our fellow Muslims with Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. That's the best option. That's the fantastic option. If you don't go with that, then the second best, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. And the least is Assalamu alaikum. And that suffices, insha'Allah. Obviously, the one who goes with the full, he will get more reward bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. Allah states in the Noble Quran, وَإِذَا حُيِّيتُم بِتَحِيَّةٍ فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّوهَا. If you are greeted with the greeting, then you respond in a better manner. Somebody says to you, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, you should say, وَعَلَيْكُمْ السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. What does this mean? This is a dua for your fellow Muslim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. I come to you in peace. I come to you in a state of peace. I do not want to harm you, and I do not want anyone else to also harm you. I want salam upon you and the rahmah of Allah. I'm making dua for you. I want Allah's rahmah to encompass you. Wa barakatuh, and for you to find barakah in this world and in the hereafter. If we really meant the salam, would we backbite? Would we cheat? Would we slander one another? No, we wouldn't. Allahu musta'an. The first piece of advice our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave when he entered Medina al-Munawwara was this matter here. From amongst others, he said, Afshu salama baynakum. Spread the salam amongst you, O the people of Medina al-Munawwara. So Ya Abdullah, Ya Amat Allah, it is sunnah for you to greet your fellow Muslim brothers and sisters, and it is wajib for them to respond. Ajib. The matter of salam, it is sunnah for you to initiate the greeting, but for them to respond after they have been greeted, it is a must. It is wajib by consensus of the scholars. Walhamdulillah. And who is better, the one who responds or the one who initiates the salam? Obviously, the one who initiates the salam is the better of the two people, walhamdulillah. And if you greet, there's a group of individuals and you entered the masjid or you entered a halaqa and there's 20 people there and you gave a general salam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, to all, for example, that was your intention, then it would suffice if one of the people responded to your salam. Not every one of them has to respond to your salam. One response from any of them will suffice, walhamdulillah. And so make it your norm, make it your practice that whoever you see from amongst the Muslims, that you greet them in the shopping center, in the park, at the masjid, wherever it might be. And especially if you are a seeker of sacred knowledge, then there's more responsibility upon you, walhamdulillah. Afshu salam bainakum, spread the salam amongst you. And if you do so, then love will spread amongst you, walhamdulillah. The second etiquette, insha'Allah, is the matter of isti'idhan, seeking permission before you enter into any private space. If you want to enter a house, a room, you need to seek permission first. You need to wait on the right-hand side or the left-hand side, not directly in front of the door. And then if permission is given, then you enter. And if no permission is given, if you are denied entry, then you leave. If they say to you, come back later, then you come back later. And you do not have any resentment in your heart. Allah mentions in the Noble Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَدْخُلُوا بُيُوتًا غَيْرَ بُيُوتِكُمْ حَتَّى تَسْتَأْنِسُوا. That all you who believe, do not enter into a house which is not your home, except that you seek permission. This is obviously for private spaces, somebody's house, a room, an office where the door is closed, etc. The norm and the customs of the people dictates this matter. We're not talking about public spaces. An example, you come to the house, you knock on the door, you say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, I'm looking for brother Ahmed, and you wait. On the right, on the left, not in front of the door. They open the door and you are peeping into the house. You are looking into the house. You are invading their privacy. This is unbecoming upon you to do this. Allahu musta'an. And if they say to you, no, come back later. We are busy right now. وَإِن قِيلَ لَكُمْ ارْجِعُوا فَارْجِعُوا. If you are told, go back, come back later, then you do so. This is the Quranic prescription. And so if you leave with some resentment in your heart, what's wrong with them? I came and while they're not opening, etc., then you have an issue, because Allah states in the Quran, go back and then you return later on. If that is the case, then people have excuses. People might be busy, they have an issue, they have a problem, etc. It's not the appropriate time. And so come back when appropriate, bi-iznillahi ta'ala. And if you knocked once, you knocked twice, you knocked thrice, and there's absolutely no response whatsoever, then after three times, you leave bi-iznillahi ta'ala, and then you can come back later, insha'Allah. And if they ask who is there, you don't say me, as is common with many people. Who is there? Me. Who's me? It's I. Who's I? We don't know. Give your name, subhanAllah. And lastly, Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, knock on the door decently, with respect. Do not bang on the door, etc. I mean, subhanAllah, we are all familiar with this, that somebody's come to the home and they're banging on the door. They're knocking so hard. Everyone thinks, what's going on? Maybe there's an emergency or something of the sort. Allahu musta'an. And what would people say about the one who bangs on doors, etc.? People would say, where's their manners? Where's their behavior? Did their parents not teach them proper etiquettes and manners? Subhanallah. The Muslim is supposed to be somebody who embodies good behavior, etiquettes and manners, and especially the student of knowledge. So we covered the matter of salam and we covered the matter of isti'idhan, walhamdulillah. We now move on to the third on the list of 10 adab, and that is taking the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before eating and drinking. Allah is the one who provided this food for you, and so you take the name of Allah before you eat and before you drink. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to that young boy, Ya ghulam, sammillah wa kul biyameenik. O little boy, take the name of Allah and eat with your right hand. So we say Bismillah before we eat, walhamdulillah. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, can I say Bismillahi Rahmani Rahim? Can I say Bismillahi wa ala barakatillah? Can I add to the Bismillah? We find that some ulama, Imam al-Nawawi and others, they state, yes, it is fine, no problem at all, you can add and it is good. Whereas others state, no, it is better to just stick to Bismillah, and that probably might be the better option. Just stick to Bismillah, insha'Allah. And what if I forget to say Bismillah at the beginning of eating? And I mean, the middle of my meal, what do I say now? Do I make qada of my bismillah? Our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam taught us that we say bismillahi awwalahu wa akhirahu. Bismillah for the beginning and bismillah for the end. Walhamdulillah. We eat with the left hand or the right hand? We eat with our right hand. When we go to the toilet, etc., we cleanse ourselves, we use the left. For all good matters, when we shake hand with somebody, we shake with the right hand. And so we eat with our right hands. Walhamdulillah. Even if somebody says, well, I'm left-handed, when you are eating, brother, you eat with your right hand. Walhamdulillah. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, also in terms of etiquettes while eating, that you eat the food that is in front of you. You don't try to look for the food that's on the other end of the table, eat from other places. Except obviously, if the salad's on the other side of the table, you want the chicken and the chicken's on the other side, whereas the mutton is in front of you, then you can ask for it, no problem at all. But generally, you should eat that which is closest to you. And especially in those days, that they would have everyone eating from maybe one plate. And it is rude, it's unbecoming. It's a person who lacks etiquettes, that they all eating the same food, rice and biryani or whatever, but he's not eating from the rice in front of him. He's putting his hands and he's eating from the area of the others. He's eating from the share of the others. Everyone and anybody would say, brother, what's wrong with you? I mean, where's your manners, your etiquettes? How can you behave in this manner? But if the salad's on the other end of the table, if the chicken's on the other end of the table and you request that, please pass me the chicken, no problem with that. Walhamdulillah. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, we also find that when you are done eating, then you should lick your fingers, as our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam had stated. And if you used a spoon, then you make sure that the spoon is also clean, that you lick the spoon. We do not want any amount of food to go to waste. You don't know where the barakah is to be found, subhanallah. And imagine if the Sharia emphasized that small amount there that you shouldn't waste, what about wasting plates and plates of food? Allahu musta'an. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, once we have eaten and taken our full, then we say Alhamdulillah. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam states that you say Alhamdulillah when you are done eating, and that's the minimum. Alhamdulillah is the minimum. And you find there are various narrations. Alhamdulillah alladhi at'amana wa saqana wa ja'alana min al-muslimin. There's that one, and there's many others. The ulama state that the minimum is that you praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you say Alhamdulillah, or any of the other versions, all is good. Walhamdulillah. So we covered the matter of salam, we covered the matter of seeking permission before entering private spaces, and number three, the etiquettes when you are eating, the bismillah, the alhamdulillah at the end, and Allah grant you barakah in all of that. The fourth etiquette that Sheikh Usaimi advises us and lists here is what? تَكَلَّمْ بِطِيبِ الْقَوْلِ فِي خَيْرٍ. Speak good, speak that which is good. And so we learn from this, مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرًا أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. Whoever believes in Allah and in the final day, then let him speak that which is good or be silent. Who said this? Our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith reported by Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim, that speak good or be silent. That yourself, don't raise your voice unnecessarily. Don't be somebody who's loud. They say about so and so, he's very, very loud, Allahu musta'an. Very rude, Allahu musta'an. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, do not raise your voice unnecessarily. When you are speaking, don't speak too fast, and don't be too slow. Rather speak in a manner that people can easily comprehend you. Also, listen attentively when others are speaking. Don't interrupt them. Don't butt in when they are talking. Ansit liman kallamak. Listen attentively to the person who is speaking to you. Subhanallah. Istima' means that you are listening to the person who is speaking. Whereas insat is that you give them your full attention. Not only are you listening, but rather you are focused upon them. You are looking at them. You are not fidgeting with anything here, there and everywhere. We find this hadith of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he was in the gathering of the Sahaba and he had his ring and he was playing with this ring. At the end of the majlis, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got rid of that ring. And so when he was asked why, he said, because this ring, it distracted me from you people, subhanallah. And so the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got rid of it. Why? Because it was distracting to him. He wasn't really focused on those who were around him. Imagine ourselves with our mobile phones, Allahu musta'an. So Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, you listen and you are also attentive to the person who is speaking. Don't interrupt them, this is rude. And also, if you interrupt them and you butt in, then you most likely will come with an incorrect response to what they are saying because you haven't heard them out properly. And when there are elders around, then one should give preference to them. One shouldn't speak when the elders are around. Give them preference. Let them speak first and then you speak later, inshallah. And we say those who are elder or those who are higher in you in rank. So kabbir, kabbir, as the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had stated, those who are senior than you. That's a better word. Those who are senior than you. And seniority could be in age, could be in rank. This is the Amir, this is the Sultan, this is the Alim, this is the scholar, this is the Muhaddith, etc. This is the older person of the family. And so we give them preference. And this is out of honoring them and honoring their position. Walhamdulillah. So Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatallah, this was to do with the matter of our tongues, the matter of our speech. Bi'ithnillahi ta'ala, we have one mouth and we have two ears. And thus we should be listening more than speaking. Walhamdulillah. The fifth etiquette, Ya Abdullah, Ya Amat Allah, O student of knowledge, O Muslim, is that when you are ready to sleep, it is highly recommended that you take wudu before you go to sleep. You lie on your right hand side, you recite Ayatul Kursi before you fall asleep, and then you recite the three quls. Qul huwa Allahu ahad, qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq, qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas. You recite these three surahs, and then you blow into your hands. Blow into your hands after the recitation of these three surahs, and then you wipe this on your entire body, and whatever you can reach, inshallah. We don't go into exaggeration that every tiny spot on my body I need to touch. No. Three surahs, blow onto your hands, and then you wipe on your body. And then you read these three surahs once more, and you do the same. And then a third time, you recite these three surahs, you blow into your hands and then you wipe on your entire body. Alhamdulillah. And that's protection for yourself. Bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. This is the etiquette before you go to sleep. There's obviously many other matters. Recitation of Surah Mulk, etc. There's a long list. But we are sticking to the minimum. Bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. And so, Ya Abdullah, Ya Amat Allah, Ya Talib al-Ilm, O student of knowledge, take your wudu. Read Ayatul Kursi, sleep on your right hand side, sleep on your right side. Read these three surahs and blow and wipe on your entire body. Walhamdulillah. And bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you. What is the point in studying the 40 ahadith of Imam al-Nawawi and tafsir and ahadith and usul al-fiqh, etc., etc., in seerah? But these simple matters here, we fall short. Allah musta'an. May Allah grant tawfiq to the speaker, even before those who are being spoken to, walhamdulillah. And so number six, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. And number six is that when you sneeze, then you cover your nose, you cover your mouth, and then you say alhamdulillah. And if anyone's around you, then they should say yarhamukallah after hearing your alhamdulillah. And when you hear them say yarhamukallah, which means may Allah have mercy upon you, then you make dua for them. Yahdikumullah wa yuslihu balakum. May Allah guide you and correct your affairs. And so we learn number one, that when we sneeze, we should cover your nose, cover your mouth, so that you do not have all of these droplets going everywhere. You don't spray the people around you. And also when you are sneezing, that sight, people don't want to see that. Allahu musta'an. And so it prevents all of this droplets from spreading. It prevents the germs from moving to others. And nobody wants that which is from your nose to land on them. Allahu musta'an. Especially if you're in a public area. So Ya Abdullah, Ya Amat Allah, cover your nose, cover your mouth. If you need, cover your face. And so prevent the droplets from spreading. Say alhamdulillah, they will say inshallah, they will say yarhamukallah, and then you counter with making dua for them, and you can say yahdikumullah wa yuslihu balakum, or as some state, any other dua you make for them. Walhamdulillah. And so this was to do with when you sneeze, inshallah. And the seventh etiquette, still sticking to the face, is that when you yawn, and we all yawn, subhanallah, and when we yawn, then you should cover your mouth with your hand. Cover your mouth and maybe use the back of your hand here. Cover your mouth so that people do not see, and one shouldn't make any sounds, ah, oh, etc. None of these sounds, subhanallah. And we are familiar with these sounds. And then you keep your mouth open wide like a hippopotamus. This is unbecoming upon the Muslim. etiquettes require and demand that you restrain it as far as possible. You restrain that yawn as far as possible. And while doing that, you also cover up your mouth bi-ithnillahi ta'ala and you don't emit any sound whatsoever. Walhamdulillah. The eighth etiquette, ya Muslim, ya Abdullah, ya Amatallah, ya Talib al-ilm, O student of knowledge, is that when you come to a gathering, whether it's a halaqa, a program, etc., then you shouldn't cross over people and push people, etc., to find a spot to sit between people. Two brothers are sitting next to one another, two friends, and you want to come there and you want to sit in between both of them. This is rude. And people would say, I mean, how rude of you, Allah musta'an. They might not say it, but they definitely think it. So, ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah, when you come to a gathering, you give the salam if appropriate. Maybe it's in the middle of the majlis, you don't want to verbalize the salam. You sit quietly. Wherever the halaqa ended, you find a spot and you sit there, insha'Allah. What is unbecoming is that you walk over people, you cross between people, you disturb the majlis and the gathering. And this is obviously if people are sitting close to one another. But if there's somebody sitting here and somebody there and someone here and someone there, and it's easy for you to find space, then there's no problem with you finding that space, insha'Allah. And if you come to two individuals and there's a space in between and you want to sit there, then you need to ask them permission. Can I sit here? Anyone seated here? Can I please sit here, etc.? You need to seek permission because maybe the two friends and they don't want anyone sitting in between them. Allah musta'an. Ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah. So we do not want to disturb and we do not want to cause any inconvenience. And also, you shouldn't cause any individual to stand up and give you their seat. They were there first, they have that haq, and you shouldn't cause anyone to give you their seat. Yes, if they volunteer this and they want to give it, they feel out of respect to you, etc., no problem bi-ithnillahi ta'ala, that's their haq. But you shouldn't ask them, please, can you move and let me sit here or something of the sort. Also, ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah, those who are already in the majlis, when you see somebody new coming, then try to make space for them bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. Welcome them and you make space for them bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. In any majlis, we should try to make the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let not a majlis end without us taking the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Send salawat upon the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we also know the kafara of a majlis, the expiation of the majlis. In the majlis, maybe you said something bad about somebody. Maybe there was ghiba, there was namima. Maybe the fact that you spoke ill of a group of people, whatever, something might have happened. And so it's good to make kafara of that majlis. And what's the kafara of the majlis? For you to say, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. That glory be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I testify that there's no deity worthy of worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Astaghfiruk, I seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa atubu ilayk, wa Allah, wipe away my sins and I make tawbah to you. And this insha'Allah wipes away whatever wrong was said in that majlis. Walhamdulillah. Ya Abdullah, ya Amatullah, the ninth etiquette as listed by Sheikh Usaymi, the haq of the tariq and public spaces, and so the rights of the road and all public spaces, that when you are in public, that you lower your gaze. You're not somebody who's inquisitive, looking here and there and staring at people. You're at the beach, you're at the park, wherever you might be. I mean, somebody's staring, you're walking and this guy's just staring at you. People would be like, what's wrong with him? Why are you staring at me? Why are you so inquisitive? Lower your gaze. And so we obviously need to embody the best of manners. So don't be inquisitive and staring at people. Lower your gaze. Don't cause any harm. In terms of harm, watch how you park. Do not inconvenience anyone. You go for Salatul Jumu'ah or any other Salah, watch the manner that you park. You're at the shopping center. I mean, park properly. Don't park in the manner that you've taken up two parking bays. Allahu musta'an. Don't dirty the area. Don't be a litter bug, littering left, right, and center. You went to the park and you had your picnic and now there's so much of filth that you have left behind. Allahu musta'an. The rights of the road and the rights of public spaces. Also, in public spaces, you respond to the salam. You should give people their salam. You should order good and you should forbid evil. Walhamdulillah. So this was the ninth etiquette. And we move on to the last of these etiquettes, bi-ithnillahi ta'ala, that you wear good and appropriate clothing. And we know the best color, as the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has stated, is white. The best color is white. Why? Because you would require washing it much more often. You have a black garment, you can wear it for 10 months and nobody would know. But you wear a white garment, you need to wash it after a day or two, because the dirt is easily visible upon it. And thus, by you washing it, you're obviously wearing cleaner clothes all the time. Walhamdulillah. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved wearing white clothes. With regards to clothes, then you wear that which is good, you wear that which is appropriate, obviously, to your gender. With regards to the males, then you try your level best to keep your garments above the ankle. And there's a long debate with regards to this mas'ala here. We state that if you are wearing a thobe, if you're wearing a kurta, etc., then it is highly recommended that you keep it above the ankle, because that type of garment looks odd when it is below the ankle. But if you're wearing trousers and shirt, etc., then still try your level best. But we find that the four schools of jurisprudence, they state that if your trousers are lowered below the ankle and it's nothing to do with pride, then this would be permissible bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. And obviously the greater details with regards to this matter are in the books of fiqh, walhamdulillah. When we are dressing, we begin with the right hand side. So you're putting on your jersey, put on from the right hand side. When you are putting on your pants, begin with the right, insha'Allah. And when you are undressing, then you begin with the left, bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. Ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah, with that we have concluded the 10 etiquettes, manners, protocols, walhamdulillah, required upon every single Muslim and more especially the student of knowledge. Number one was the matter of salam and the etiquettes related to it. Number two, seeking permission before entering into private spaces. Number three, bismillah before you eat, bismillah before you drink, praise Allah when you are done. Number four, speaking that which is good, listening to people attentively, not interrupting them. Number five, the etiquettes before you fall asleep, the three quls, blowing into your hands, rubbing on your body, reciting Ayatul Kursi and taking wudu, walhamdulillah. Number six, when you sneeze, then cover up your nose, your mouth, etc. Say alhamdulillah after sneezing. When you are yawning, try to restrain it as far as possible and cover your mouth and don't make any sounds. Number eight, that when you come to a gathering, sit at the end, don't interrupt people, don't disturb the gathering, don't move and take up the space of others. If there's space, no problem bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. Between two people, seek permission before you sit down. Number nine, the rights of public spaces, the right of the road. Watch how you park. Don't be staring at people. Allah musta'an. And lastly, number 10, ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah, that dress appropriately. Carry yourself out in a dignified manner. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us. We ask Allah to grant us tawfiq. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us tawfiq to embody these etiquettes and these manners. Imagine our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the embodiment of refined manners, subhanallah. There's not a bird flying in the sky except that if we required knowledge about it, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave it to us, as the companion had stated. And so, ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah, carry yourself out in a dignified manner, and more especially because you are Muslim, you're an ummati of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and most especially because you are a student of knowledge. Walhamdulillah. Until we meet again, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.